Hello, one all, is my review of My Hero Academia Vigilantes, Chapter 94, The Underground Masquerade Case. And now that we've officially come to the end of this flashback, I just have to ask, why? What was the point of this flashback? What was it trying to say? It's not like we got any big reveals or huge plot twists we didn't see coming, so what was the purpose of any of this? I mean, it was cool seeing some of the heroes in their younger days before they became heroes, before, you know, Rappa became an official villain, all that, but I feel like, you know, there has to be something more here. I feel like there's something else that this flashback is supposed to do. And I do have some theories on that. I mean, first and foremost, we have All For One talking about how he really, really wants to get Overclock, O'Clock's quirk, and how he's already decided how he'll put it to use. But I really can't imagine that his whole big plan for the quirk was to create sex, was to create a Nomu who wanted to become a hero that was beloved by the people. I mean, certainly having a hero that's secretly working for you would be to his advantage, but there are just a ridiculous number of plot holes in Six's plan to become a hero, so much so that I can't even imagine that All For One was in on that plan, that All For One ordered him to do that. It feels much more like Six went rogue, went off to do his own thing, and maybe All For One had his own plan, his own idea of how that quirk was going to be used, but Six did something different, and Six essentially betrayed him. And if that is the case, I could certainly see Vigilantes ending with Six being recaptured by All For One, who takes the quirk and gives it to someone else. Someone who has that quirk in the main series, but just hasn't revealed it yet. I mean, there's been a lot of talk, a lot of theories, a lot of speculation about the UA traitor, someone in Class 1A, someone in Class 1B, someone among the faculty who's secretly working for All For One. And it could certainly be revealed after the series comes to an end. They have O'Clock's quirk, they have Overclock, and that's how they're going to end up betraying everyone by, you know, literally running circles around them. That could certainly be interesting. I think another purpose of this flashback, though, was to talk about Rappa, to get him, you know, back into our collective minds, and to foreshadow his eventual return to the main series, because I'm not going to lie, Rappa certainly did not leave any lasting impact on me when I read about him in the main series, but now, you know, after this whole flashback, I really do like him as a character, and I want to see him come back. Also, we had Fat Gum appear quite heavily in the flashback, even though he didn't really do all that much. And let's not forget that after Rappa and Fat Gum fought, they both developed a certain level of respect for the other. So if there comes a point in the main series where heroes, you know, need to recruit villains because they simply don't have enough manpower, I could certainly see Fat Gum basically writing a letter of recommendation saying, hey, we should bring in Rappa, he was really helpful, and, you know, he was super nice to me after I beat him in that fight. Also, I just really need to point something out about Fat Gum. Last chapter, I half-jokingly said, well, maybe he became fat because, you know, all those villains ran him over and he wants to make sure that can never happen again. That is literally confirmed this chapter. Fat Gum literally says he needs to start putting on some weight so he can't be shoved around by villains. Oh, I love it. My theories come true. I freaking love it. We also have Mirka, who definitely developed a very, very interesting bond with Rappa throughout this flashback. I mean, this look she gives him before she parts ways, it's very, very seductive. I mean, I've never really found Mirko all that attractive, but right here, she is drop-dead goddamn gorgeous. And I think she might be flirting a little with Rappa here. I so ship them together simply because I want to see their children. What is the child of Rappa and Mirko like? I would love an entire spin-off series, just, you know, them living together, raising kids, her still getting into fights while she's 9 months pregnant. Oh, please, please, let that be the next spinoff. We also get this great shot of his unmasked face before he leaves, and I could definitely see that being necessary if he ends up appearing in the next couple chapters of the main series, because there is a fairly decent chance that they put him in Tartarus, which, you know, anyone who's caught up in the main series knows why that's a big deal right now, just saying. So yeah, my best guess up to this point is that the flashback occurred to foreshadow O'Clock's quirk being used by the UA traitor, and to foreshadow Rappa's eventual return on the side of the heroes, more or less, and probably him dating and marrying Mirko. I'm very, very excited to see everything happens with those two. Cannot freaking wait for that. Anyway, rest of the chapter, we have Almaze being celebrated for stopping 100 villains in one fell swoop, setting a new record for the hero. And I'm a little concerned by that word villains, because they weren't actually villains. They were being manipulated and controlled by All For One, and I'm really hoping someone noticed that, and they weren't, you know, basically just thrown into Tartarus without a trial or anything. That is just, you know, a little bit concerning right there. Also do love, you know, All Might rescuing the injured and reinforcing damaged buildings, clearing away rubble before he left. I just freaking love that someday there will become a point where Deku will be able to do that. And I don't just mean, like, physically. I mean, there will come a point where Deku no longer breaks all his bones in every fight and he can actually stay behind to help with a freaking cleanup. I mean, seriously, has that dude ever gotten into a fight that he's been able to walk away from? Even when he wins, he's still basically catatonic afterwards. Also, I freaking love Might Sleep. All Might sleeping as he flies away. God dang, that dude is too OP. And then we have Hood giving a bit of a temper tantrum about how he could still fight, only for All For One to take him down in all of 2 seconds flat. God, I love this man's power. He is truly, truly, truly terrifying. And then he uses his finger technique to pierce the dude's brains and teeth and put him to sleep, which, yeah, that was terrifying. That was definitely terrifying. I mean, it's definitely clear that this, you know, this version of Hood is a prototype for the Nomu. He's not finished by any stretch of the imagination. We know that because we actually see his finished version, which I think might actually be foreshadowed here a little bit because he said bulking up from the very start might have been the best way to crush them, actually. And then later on, the finalized version of Hood that Endeavor ends up fighting is much bigger from the start. So maybe they decided that the transforming from small to big wasn't helpful, so they just had him stay big permanently? That's the best guess I can come up with, at least. And it just makes me really wonder, what exactly did they do to Kurogiri to make him come out so well when Hood is this violent, rampaging ball of madness? I mean, seriously, Kurogiri's calm, collected, able to reason properly, and in full control of his quirk. Well, Hood is just, you know, insane. Very, very curious about that. Anyway, then Mirko decides to run away rather than, you know, getting involved with the cops, because it would certainly look bad for her and her school if she gets caught fighting an underground fighting ring again. Rappa heads out to basically saying, oh yeah, he's gonna go right back in underground fighting, especially if it means, you know, he gets involved in All For One and all that business again, because he really, really loves fighting, because of course he does. God dang, this man's insane. Seriously, he would have made a great hero. I mean, he could have fought people and get paid for it. What more could he want? So I guess he considered that, you know, a violation of the sacred honor of man versus fist. Actually, wait, no. He got paid for the underground fighting ring stuff, so yeah. No reason beside his violent temperament that he could not become a great hero. Then in the next page, I actually get a very small detail that I really like. Someone pointed out to me online. All Might and O'Clock racing back and forth. That's basically a reference to Superman versus The Flash. I did not catch that. That was such a cool little detail. I love it. Anyway, basically, O'Clock decides that he's going to investigate this all by himself because he knows that the bad guy, whoever it is, could be able to stop him if he went through official channels, which is just such a bad idea. I mean, seriously, if at any point in all this, he had just contacted All Might, the two of them had partnered up on this, they could have taken out All For One, or at least been aware that he survived the attack and that he is still up and running. That would have changed the entire freaking story of the main series. But I digress. Then we go back to the present day, and Tanuma is talking about the underground fighting ring and how he realized later on that it was connected to the baddest of all the bad guys, which all got solved through that secret showdown between him and All Might behind the scenes. How does Tanuma know about the secret showdown between All Might and All For One? Seriously, the top heroes don't even know about it. Endeavor, Best Genius, none of them knew who All For One was, and yet Tanuma, this detective, is aware of it. I have so many questions about this fight. I mean, seriously, even refers to it as a secret showdown, so who exactly knew about it? Who was aware of it? Where the freak did it happen? I've seen some people speculating maybe it was on an island somewhere off the coast, something like that. I mean, a fight this large, people would have noticed. Did the government play a role in hiding it, making sure that people weren't aware of it? I mean, I could certainly see that being the case. It definitely seemed like when Deku was first told about All For One, that All Might seemed to be implying that the government itself was working to have him essentially erased from history to make sure no one knew about him. Because even just knowing about him, even just his existence being out there, threatens the peace of hero society. That's how overwhelmingly dangerous this man is. But as Tanuma's thinking about this, he suddenly realizes, you know, they're all connected. The instant villains, the terrorist attacks, Pop going crazy, all of it, it must be done by the same man. He basically realizes that All For One is still alive, or at least he's a step away from realizing it. At this point, I had to kind of put down the chapter a little bit and think to myself, wait a minute, there's something very, very wrong here. If Tanuma realized All For One is alive, or at least he was about to, then why didn't All Might know that All For One was alive? I mean, All Might didn't know about it until the other detective came and told him that the villain he fought had multiple quirks from multiple people. So, yeah, it's at this point that I realize, oh, Tanuma's gonna die, isn't he? And then when this guy comes in to ask about the paperwork, I'm thinking to myself, oh yeah, Tanuma's gonna die, that's six, isn't he? And then Tuma, for whatever reason, decides to start bragging to this person who he's never seen, but who apparently works in the same police station as him, about how he just made this big connection between these two huge cases. And then the dude reveals himself to be six, blows up the file, and probably murders Tanuma. I've heard some people speculate maybe he wasn't actually killed, maybe just like in a coma or something, but that would have to be a freaking long coma. I mean, this is a year or two before the start of the main series, so it would have to be like at least a 2-3 year long coma. That seems kind of unlikely, but the police station's blown up, and Six manages to escape. And then O'Clock comes and talks to him and congratulates him. Yeah, that's interesting. And there is some speculation this might be O'Clock's quirk vestige, like the piece of his soul that was bound to his quirk that's now inside Six, but, you know, he's praising him way too much. He isn't acting like you'd expect O'Clock to work, so Six might just be insane. Or, on the other hand, maybe All For One found a way to brainwash the quirk vestiges into working with him? I mean, that would definitely be interesting, definitely a game changer. That could be what this whole, you know, flashback is foreshadowing, but that doesn't seem all that likely. Anyway, so now Six has destroyed all the evidence, the only person that could tie the two pieces of evidence together, about the connection between All For One, the instant quirk villains, and himself. So, yeah, now he's free to go murder Pop, and probably Koyuchi as well, and I am very, very excited to see exactly what happens next. We've been waiting a long time for the big showdown, you know? Koyuchi versus Six. What's gonna happen? I am hoping Koyuchi learned a bit of a lesson from O'Clock, from Knuckle Duster, and he doesn't try to do this alone. I mean, he has teamed up with the three stooges who are helping him out. But I really feel like he should call in some extra backup. Maybe Eraserhead? That'd be helpful. But yeah, so next chapter, I guess we're gonna have the big fights. My guess, at least for right now, is that Six is gonna, you know, set up a bunch of explosions on the other side of town when all the heroes go over there to investigate and check on it and help the people. He's gonna attack the hospital and try to kill Pop and Koichi because they're basically the last witnesses who can really tie him to anything. So yeah, that's bad. But on the bright side, we are finally gonna get the big climatic battle. Koichi versus Six. Who's gonna win? I mean, I'm gonna say Koichi? It'd certainly be a shocking twist if Six ends up winning this fight, kills him, kills Pop, and then, I don't know, goes back to working for All For One. My best guess, again, is that Six is going to end up severely injured, half-dead, escape just barely, and then All For One's going to, you know, recapture him, take the quirk from him, and like I theorized before, give it to someone else. Maybe someone in Class 1A so that they can essentially work as his puppet, work as the traitor of UA, more or less. At least that's my best guess, but please, let me know what you think. What do you think the point of this flashback was? I mean, like I said, Rappa is definitely really heavily implied to be returning in the main series. If he is in Tartarus, he could certainly end up appearing in the next chapter, maybe, you know, the one after that. That'd definitely be interesting. And what's Six gonna do now? How is he gonna go after Pop and Koyuchi? What's his big master plan? And do you think All For One is backing this plan? I mean, like I said before, it really feels like there's just too many holes in the plan. It's too haphazard for it to be actually designed by the genius, brilliant strategist that is All For One. But yeah, let me know what you think about all that down below. And until next time, peace!